Yeah, let's get started. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 231. I'm going to call this one, the House Parity Hearing is Tuesday. Because it is. Well, it depends on when you're watching this. I'm recording Friday, January 8th, 2016, and it's next Tuesday. So you might be seeing it this weekend. Might be seeing it a long time from now. I don't know. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. The reason that I'm doing this, we'll tell you what. First, Ham Radio Now brought to you by you. There's Arvin back there. Arvin also appears on our website. You can see him there in the on the right-hand side. If you want to help us out with a financial contribution, stop by hamradionow.tv and click on Arvin. And thank you very much. Pretty good last year. I wanted to detail last year's contributions in detail, but I don't want to do it this time because I got a lot of stuff to get through here that's all important. This is what I'm getting at for this episode. I got this letter from Dan Henderson at headquarters, and the reason I got this letter was because of this hearing. Whoops, things are taking a little while to react here on my browser. The House Energy and Commerce Subcommittee on Communications and Technology has scheduled a hearing Tuesday, January 12th. And one of the things they're going to check out is House Bill 1301, the Amateur Radio Parity Act. And the reason that Dan sent me this email is my congressperson, Renee Elmers, in my district, is on this committee. And she is a co-sponsor of the bill. So he wanted me to make sure I remind her to get in there and vote. So we'll find out more about that in just a minute. I don't want to waste a lot of time, but I want to waste a little time. Every once in a while, somebody says, why the big headphones, Gary? I mean, other than it being very podcastery, this is your basic antique podcasting setup. You know, I'm sitting here with all my equipment surrounding me, and I've got the headphones and the microphone and the boom and all that stuff. A lot of podcasts have moved on to something more professional. Even a lot of the Twit programs have gone to something more professional. Although Leo still does a couple of his shows in his office with the big headphones and the boom mic and the aisle mic on it. And all that stuff in standard, traditional antique podcast fashion. Here's a good reason why. This is the new, this week's Ham Nation. Here's a good reason why to do antique podcasting with headphones. So this is the intro to the show, and this is the way the mix should sound when you hear a voice against the music.
This is Ham Nation, episode number 229, January 6, 2016. We experiment with the gas-powered soldering station and run down the audio alley.
Yeah.
Hello, everybody.
Okay, so they do all that stuff. And the gas-powered soldering station, if you haven't seen it, I'll take a look at that. It's pretty funny. So Bob Heil did the introduction. They do that cold when they do the program. They don't run the introduction when he's starting the program. If you've ever watched it live, they just kind of start cold. And they mix all that stuff in post-production later. The editors do that when they finish putting the program together. Okay, so they set the mix level between Bob's voice and the music background. So Bob's the audio expert. And he decided he wanted to play a little bit more of the music and play with his mixer and stuff. And this is how that worked out.
You're tuned to Ham Nation. It's 2016.
Hello.
And
Bob.
A great show about.
Hello.
Radio.
Can't hear you, Bob.
Hearing in the background is WB6.
The background. Not in the background, Bob. Very foreground. And notice
our friend Joe Walsh.
Yes.
And did. Joe wrote, plays this theme.
Plays
every
it
week
again.
When you listen to the replays, a lot of you watch it live.
What? What?
16?
Turn it down.
Here you are. Our own theme song.
Turn down the damn music, you damn kids. Get off the lawn. So, notice that Bob's not wearing headphones there. I don't know if he's got an ear monitor anywhere or not. I'm not seeing anything. So he couldn't hear his mix. At least he couldn't hear it right. Or he would have been able to tell that he was inaudible in the background behind the music, which he said was in the background. And it wasn't. Okay, so enough of that. I like to needle that a little bit now and then. Oh, one of the reasons why is, for example, I sent Dale my Ham's Night Before Christmas and said, it might be cool to play that on your last show before Christmas. And Dale, their video guy, said, Dale Puckett said, this is great. Yeah, I'm going to put that up there. And then he had to send me email saying, sorry, Gary, you got vetoed. I'm a former host of the program, guest host. So Bob likes me very much. And with good reason, I've needled him a lot. So anyway, you didn't see, most of you have seen Ham's Night Before Christmas, but the folks on Ham Nation didn't get to see it. They got to see Bob playing the organ. Okay, so we got that email from Dan. Next stop on our tour is this website, and this is something called govtrack.us. Right up there, govtrack.us. It's a website where you can look up the status of bills, and if you're interested in following the product, the process, the progress of a bill, you can have them email you whenever something happens. And so I've been following the progress of HR 1301, the Amateur Radio Parity Act of 2015, and that also gives me a moment to admit something I screwed up. I don't know if I don't think I screwed it up on the program. I screwed it up in some bulletin boards on Reddit. I thought, and I think I've always thought, that a legislative session was 1 year. And so if something got introduced toward the beginning of the year, like this one was, and it gets to the end of the year and it hasn't been acted on, it dies. It expires. And I was only off by a year. The sessions are 2 years long. The Congresses are 2 years long. And so this current Congress is 2015 and 2016. And so the Parity Act was introduced in 2015, and it keeps on going this year, which is a good thing because it didn't get passed in last year's legislative sessions, but it's got another year to go. So maybe we'll get there. Before the Senate picked it up, I didn't rate its chances as very high, and neither did these guys. When the Senate picked it up, we both raised our estimate of the possibilities. These guys have a rating on the website. We'll get down to that in just a minute. Well, here we go. Prognosis, 10% chance of being enacted, and they're also noticing that Senate Bill 1685, which we'll talk about in a little bit, is the same bill. But 10% of being enacted in the House. So here's its history. It was introduced on March 4th, so pretty early in the year. And then there's some other stuff going on. Where does it say? Oh, here we go. It's scheduled for a committee meeting January 12th, 10:15 a.m. So that's the notice that it's coming up. Let's see. These are the co-sponsors. You can get a list of all the co-sponsors. There's quite a few now in the House and a couple of them in the Senate. And let's see, a 21% chance of getting past the committee. And there's that 10% chance of being enacted. So what else have I got here? That's the committee. Wrong button. There we go. The House Energy and Commerce Committee. It is chaired by Greg Walden. Greg is this guy, W7EQI. Very modest on his QRZ page. I don't think he put anything in there. VU3JAU. I think it's India. Managing the page. I don't understand that at all. But in any case, that's Greg. I think he's one of two hams in the House of Representatives, I think I was told. I don't know who the other one is. So anyway, there's the committee. Greg is the chairman. He's from Oregon. He's one of the Republicans on the committee. Let's see. There's the guy who introduced it, Adam Kitzinger from Illinois. And there's my congressperson, congresswoman, Renee Elmers here in North Carolina. I got gerrymandered out of a district. I've been represented for a long, long time by David Price. And then the last time they redrew the districts in 2010, I guess, got gerrymandered out. Renee's district is a real weird-looking horseshoe-shaped thing. And I'm in one little corner right at the top end of one of the horseshoes. So, new congressperson. But at least she's a sponsor of the bill, a co-sponsor of the bill. But then so is, I think so is David Price. I think he was. Well, G.K. Butterfield is from North Carolina. And I don't see David Price here. So maybe not. He is a Democrat. He has co-sponsored previous versions of it, but for some reason he didn't get on board for this one. Okay, so we looked at Greg. So what I've discovered is, first of all, the hearing is going to be next Tuesday. It's up in Washington. That's about a five-hour drive from here. I'm thinking of going. I'm not sure that I'm going to go, and I'll explain why in a minute. But I'm thinking of going. I think it might be interesting. I think it also might go by in a flash. And we'll see why that might be in just a minute. But I've never been to a House of Representatives anything. I've been to some minor legislative sessions in the state legislature back when we were doing the North Carolina version of PRB1. But I've never been to anything in the U.S. House. I've toured the Capitol. I don't think I've toured the White House. I've walked around it a few times. I don't think I've had the official White House tour. Cindy and I visit Washington, D.C., typically on the hottest day of the year. We look for a day that's going to be well over 100 degrees. That's the day that we go up to D.C. and play tourist. So I'm thinking I'd like to do it. My schedule is clear enough that I'd be able to go up there. I don't have press credentials, so I wouldn't be able to record anything, but that's also irrelevant, as I will explain in a minute. So anyway, here's the Energy and Commerce Committee page that that talks about the hearing. They've got four bills to consider: the Parity Act, rate regulation on broadband internet access. They want to make sure that the FCC doesn't regulate broadband internet rates. Can't tell your ISP what rates to impose. Anti-spoofing Act and a Small Business Broadband Deployment Act. If you're interested in any of those, you can go dig out that stuff on your own. This is the actual hearing notice, and that's all there is right there. Just says that it is going to happen on 10:15 a.m. in the Rayburn House Office Building, room 2123, I think, on January 12th. And here's something that what I was getting at about why I might not need to go. It's going to be webcast here. Well, sort of here. And again, I'll get to a little bit more of that kind of stuff in just a second. What's next? This is just some notes. These are staff notes on the hearing. And what particularly interested me here is this witness list. I'm going to play some video in a couple of minutes of a staff hearing or a committee hearing on another subject, just something that happened a while ago. So you can see Greg Walden in action, chairing the committee, and get an idea of what these things look like. And they have witnesses. They have people who testify, pretty stilted, typically, just, kind of formal reading prepared notes and stuff, I imagine, most of the time. So here's the witness list, and this is for the all of the four items. And there's no hams in here, nobody from the league. Chris Imlay, Mike Lysenko are not in here. And that's it. There are no more witness lists. They give some details of the legislation that they're going to be considering. And here's the Parity Act one. It's pretty quick, and all the usual stuff that you've seen from the Parity Act. I don't know for sure, and I kind of wanted to talk to Chris Imlay before I did this program, and I called his office, but he was busy, like he ought to be today. So I didn't have a chance to talk to him about this. I don't know if they're going to vote on this in the committee or not on Tuesday. And they may not know themselves, but I suspect that they will. I suspect that they'll take their vote. And if they voted out of committee, then it goes, well, it's out of the subcommittee. It could either go to the whole committee or it could go to the full House. And that's a big step. Very big step. Let me see what else I've got here. Okay, so this is the thing where the webcasts are, and you can see here it is off air, so we're not seeing a live webcast at this point. But I'm going to go to this link here that says hearings and videos. It shows up here at the top as well. So there's previous webcasts that have been recorded, and you can take a look at them. And I'm going to drop down to this one, broadcasting ownership, because I'm interested in broadcasting. So we'll pop that one up. And there's a couple of the YouTube windows that opened up. And I looked at these before, and so I knew which one I wanted to see. Let's pop that up too. Well, let's go look at it on YouTube and pop it up to full screen, because they wouldn't let you do it on their website. And I'm going to drag my cursor along the bottom here, because for a long time, they're not doing anything. They started the recording probably when the committee hearing was supposed to start. And then, had nothing going on for a while. So I would just kind of randomly go into something here. Come on, YouTube. Now, their audio seems real low. Make sure my audio is up here. Yeah. Yeah, something's wrong here.
Pushing for these tax certificates.
Oh, I see what's wrong.
Way to handle this at the right time. If you were to do a bar graph of what it looks like.
Okay, so you can see
certificates, and when you don't, this is what it looks like when you don't. Imagine
you can see what the hearing looks like. And there's a witness, I think.
Go back, you'd see that the highest period of growth and ownership by women and people of color was under the tax certificate program, and those were bona fide.
And as I drag the cursor, there's another long segment where there's nothing going on. In fact, there's nothing going on at all.
We are back at those levels.
I want to see Greg Walden. There he is.
Of the hearing on ownership, and so
that's W7EQI.
I guess we go right into Q&A then, right? So let me start with a question to Mr. Waldron. Tax incentives are generally...
Okay, and now I'll let me show you a little bit of behind the scenes here in Ham Radio Now. If I got the microcam, what happened here was this is the fader that's got the browser in it.
These can take advantage of or not, depending on whether the
and
situation is.
What I wanted to do was I like to put the other stuff, the browser stuff, the Skype stuff in the right channel as I'm recording, and my voice in the left, and that lets me do a little bit of mixing things. When I'm finishing my editing. So I had it set up like that. And so I had the balance for this all the way over on the right-hand side. and they are sending me mono audio, left channel only.
It can be structured, and it's, as you point out,
turn the balance to the left channel. There they are,
market-based program
mixed in with me.
To incentivize, a little bit too loud. Minorities to get in.
Turn it over to the right channel, and it's gone. Hear it in the background because I got a couple of little speakers back there. Wrong camera. There we go. Yeah, you can sort of see them. A couple of speakers back there. Turned down very low so I don't get a lot of echo and stuff. Okay, so you didn't really want to know about that, did you? Okay, so you can see video of these hearings. If you don't get a chance to see it live on Tuesday, then you can go go watch it on playback. And once again, they are here, Energy and Commerce Committee. And it's under this thing called E&C Studio. It's where you can see those things. Okay, so we've had a look at what one of these hearings might look like, but nobody from ARRL, no hams, are scheduled to be testifying as a witness to the bill or for the bill. So that, and that could change. That could change by Tuesday. I kind of expect that it will, but I don't know for sure. I'm going to get a chance to talk to Chris. We'll see. And so that's also why I don't know whether I'm going to go up there or not. Because, again, I could be sitting in the hearing, but I couldn't record it with my camera. And I'm not sure how quickly things will get online if I want to put a program together afterwards to show what went on and probably what's going to be the little snippet that is part of the ham radio thing. Well, we'll see. I'll talk to Chris and see what he says about that. But if I do go up there, then, and Chris is there, or Mike Lysenko, or somebody else from the league, I'd have a chance to talk to them before and after and get their reaction to whatever happens and discuss a little bit more about what our future is with the Parity Act. All speculative, but maybe on the basis of a little bit more information. I mean, if it dies in this committee meeting, then it's dead. Doesn't matter whether it's still alive in the Senate, because if it dies at this hearing, it's dead for the rest of this year. It could be reintroduced in the next Congress. If it makes it past this hearing, then it either goes to the whole committee or maybe to the whole House. And it's already slated to be before the full Senate. So I'll show you a little bit about that in a couple of minutes too. So this is a big deal coming up this Tuesday, and it'd be nice to talk to the folks up there. So that would be one reason to go, but I don't understand why there's no hams listed in the witness list, and I'll try to find out about that. Got to decide by Sunday, because that tells me when I got a hotel scheduled for Monday afternoon, and the drop-dead date on canceling that is Sunday afternoon, 24-hour deal, as hotels are wont to do these days. Used to be 6 o'clock day of. Now it's usually 24 hours, 6 o'clock day before, at least with the hotel that I've got. It's way out in the suburbs, and I take the metro in. And the other thing is, I can probably bring one camera and probably can't bring tripod and microphones and all that stuff, because they give you one to go into the hearing room as a guest, as a visitor. You can bring one small bag. I could bring one of my small camera bags, probably not the tripod. I don't think I can get press credentials by Tuesday. Probably can't get them at all. But, well, who knows? You never know. I haven't tried. Haven't had a reason to. Now I kind of wish I had at least tried. Okay, so I don't know whether I'm going to go or not, but we'll see. Next, so that Senate stuff I was talking about. We're back to govtrack.us. So this is tracking the Senate version, introduced by Senator Roger Wicker, a Republican from Mississippi. And here we've got a 30% prognosis of being enacted. And it was reported out of a committee on November 18th. You probably saw this on the ARL website or various news outlets. It came out of a committee. I think I got do I have a note on what the committee is? The Senate Commerce, Science, and Transportation Committee. And they've got some subcommittees too, but it never went to a subcommittee. It was heard in this one big committee. So it has been reported out to the full Senate. So that's pretty cool. And they're talking about a 30% chance of being enacted. Is there anything down here that I wanted to get? Well, reported by committee. A committee has issued a report to the full chamber recommending the bill be considered further. And only about 1 in 4 bills are reported out of committee. So it's done well. 3 co-sponsors, Richard Blumenthal, Democrat from Connecticut, Al Franken. do you remember Al from Saturday Night Live? Now he's the senator from Minnesota. My favorite memory is the bits that he did with the satellite dish on his head, and it was slowly crushing him as he was reporting for NBC News to Saturday Night Live. It was a funny guy. He's a Democrat, you know, so a lot of you guys, Republican-type guys, disparage Al, you know. Oh, he's just a comedian. How can he be a real senator? I think he's taken to the job pretty well. Serious about what he does, and I think he's well-respected. But, of course, he's liberal, so if you're conservative, you've sort of got a bias to think that he's still just being a clown. It would be nice if you were to say, yeah, he was a clown, now he's a real senator. He's liberal, and I don't agree with his positions, but he's a real senator, and he's doing a real senator's job. Let's see, what else? 30% chance of being enacted, and that's pretty much it from there. So next, I want to show this camera. Here is the website for the Committee on Commerce, Science, and Transportation. John Thune is the chairman. Bill Nelson is the ranking member, which means he's the Democrat. He's the ranking Democrat. So this is some of the stuff that they're doing. I've got this November 18th thing circled because I wanted to go there and see what was going on. And what was going on was the committee meeting where the Senate version, S-1685, still called the Amateur Radio Parity Act, was passed along to the full Senate. And I can show you, and I think these guys put their audio in the right channel. I'll have to find out. Because I got them queued up, and they're a little bit hard to queue up. Tell you what, I'm going to put it in the center just in case. We'll see what happens. This is the bill being referred to toward the beginning of the session, getting ready to do their session.
Today we have a bipartisan slate of bills that reflect the breadth of our committee's jurisdiction, from Senator Cantwell's bill on the management of the West Coast crab fishery to legislation sponsored by Senators Wicker and Blumenthal to ensure regulatory parity for amateur radio operators.
Okay, so that was some of the stuff that this committee was going to be considering during the course of this hearing. And next is Senator Nelson. And Senator Nelson is a Democrat from Florida. And he had some comments on the bill before it was taken up that I think you'll be interested in hearing. I don't know why none of this stuff got tossed into any ham radio news programs, none that I see. I don't see them all, but I don't remember anyone bringing this up. So I think you'll be interested in seeing this. So here's Senator Nelson's comments on the Parity Act.
I'd also like to mention the Amateur Radio Parity Act. Now, I have great respect for my colleague here, Senator Blumenthal and Senator Wicker. I must oppose this bill because even though amateur radio plays an important role in the enhancing of public safety communication, we also should not force that on a homeowners association that they can stick up an antenna if the homeowners association has certain criteria on what will be the landscaping and the items on houses. And it would effectively repeal parts of millions of private contracts and agreements relied upon by homeowners around the country. This committee would be overriding the guidelines that were established and agreed to by residents of a community when they voluntarily chose to live in that community. This senator thinks that's a step too far, whereas I support I support the amateur radio, but there's got to be a happy compromise here. And finally, with
okay, so that is Senator Nelson, Senator Bill Nelson, Democrat from Florida. And so I think, you know, most of us hams think that a reasonable accommodation to be able to put in antennas in our homeowners association restricted developments so that they can't just say no, but that we can work out what we can put on is what you call a reasonable compromise, a halfway thing. Right now, we kind of feel that we don't get halfway. We get none of the way. And that's the way we feel about it. What he was saying is not new or unique or different than the arguments that have been going back and forth for some time. Okay, so next, I can control my machinery here. We go down to the actual introduction of the item and the vote, and that happens here.
And then would recognize Senator Nelson for a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move that Agenda Item 2, the West Coast Dungeness Crab Management Act, Item 3, the Reinforcing American-Made Products Act, Item 4, the Amateur Radio Parity Act, and Item 5, the Rural Health Care Connectivity Act. Hold on one second.
Keep the tension up here. Why don't
be adopted and reported favorably without amendment.
Oh, what? What? Wait a minute. He was just saying he opposed it. And now he's recommending that it be adopted and forwarded on without amendment. What's up with that?
Is there a second?
I second.
Second is heard. All in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, no.
I'd like to be recorded as a no on the amateur radio bill.
You will be so recorded. Senator Schatz also wants to be recorded as a no on that particular bill. For no other comments on that, the motion carries.
Okay. Now, the motion carries. And I guess I won't pretend to understand how the committees work and the Senate works and stuff with Senator Nelson. Saying that he opposed it and then introducing it to be passed and then voting against it. Does any of that seem like a ham radio club meeting to you? Or maybe a board of directors meeting? I've watched more of these hearings as I was trying to find these specific spots and, you know, cut them down for you. And boy, they seem like a typical radio club board meeting. We probably shouldn't watch that much of how the sausage gets made. I don't know. Senator Brian Schatz is a Democrat from Hawaii, and he's the other senator who voted against the Parity Act, which is interesting because Florida and Hawaii are two areas that are prone to ecological, climatological, you know, hurricane and other Hawaii volcanoes. disasters where ham radio comes in very handy in not just theoretical terms, but practical and, you know, it really has happened in not too distant memory. And the whole deal for these bills is we need to be able to have our antennas in our neighborhoods so that we can participate. And without getting into too many of the other arguments, people will say, well, you know, you don't really need it at your house because you don't do that much emergency stuff from your house. You just go to where the emergency is and you set up radio equipment there, which may be true. Not entirely true. We do plenty of stuff from our houses. But if we could not have ham radio in our houses, we wouldn't be hams. and we wouldn't have the wherewithal to take radio equipment to disaster situations and set it up and operate. We wouldn't know how. We wouldn't have the routine practice to be able to do it. We wouldn't have the incentive. We wouldn't have the interest. We wouldn't have even gotten started. So that argument tends to collapse, but it still gets made. And there's lots of others. So we'll deal with those on a continuing basis, but we'll see how these things fare. As the result of that vote, the bill goes on to the full Senate, but it may or may not ever be brought up for a vote there. If you've watched other bills and, you know, the political shows wrangle about various bills that may or may not come up, it may get, if it does come up, and my guess is, with the limited understanding of how these things work, it'll get attached as an amendment to another bill, more encompassing bill, but it may not. It could ride through on its own, or it could be voted down. But the House deal is the one that is the next step, and is a total go, no go coming up this Tuesday. If it gets out of this subcommittee, then it can proceed. And if it dies in the subcommittee, I think, if I understand the way things work correctly. And remember, I'm the guy that thought that everything died at the end of 1 year and learned only the other day that they die at the end of 2 years. So we're in good shape for this bill, at least. I hope. We'll see. So I may or may not go up there on Tuesday. And if I don't, I'll be watching it live and in person, and I'll do a show around what they do. And maybe I can get some guys on Skype and wrangle this thing out a little bit more. It is, I think, one of the most important things going on in ham radio. And I've done several shows on it. If this is the first time you're hearing me talk about it, look back. Just go to the hamradionow.tv website. Let me punch that up here. I think I got it still on a hot standby. The hamradionow.tv website. Let's just type in parity. P-A-R-I-T-Y. One of five. There's one. My parody rant in episode 2015, 2017. That's when I talked to Kay Kriege, ARRL president, and our local director. 197, grassroots on parity. Talked to some local guys at a ham fest. And talked to a ham named Mike, whose call sign I don't remember, who this is in the previous version, House Bill 4969. And I think that may be the first time I talked to it. Yeah, first time I talked about it. And he said, he's one of the hams who disagrees with the idea of doing this. And a lot of hams disagree with this legislation. The general thrust of their arguments is you signed a contract, you should stick to your contract and not ask to be able to weasel out of it by the big bad federal government. A lot of conservative hams who might otherwise take that position still support the Parity Act. And some of that deal is that, as I was talking to Chris Imlay and Mike Lysenko, you can look at their episode, they don't think that it is really a contract. They think it's a one-way thing. There was no negotiation. You took it or not. And they say that's not a contract. That's what do they call it? I'm not sure. They had a word for what it was, and it wasn't a two-party contract. Yeah, you signed it. Well, whatever. Let's wrap this up. I'm going to go get it online. If you've got something out of this, and I think seeing those Senate meetings is something that pretty much you have not seen. I hadn't seen them. Thought it was pretty cool. I knew that it was out there. Well, I knew that they had that meeting. I didn't know there was video. So I went digging that up just for you. So if you enjoy the Ham Radio Now program, whether you like me or not, and get something out of it, this does, you know, a lot of equipment here costs money, all that stuff. I get a lot of complaints that I spend too much time begging for money. So cutting it way back here. Stop by hamradionow.tv. Wrong button. Not cutting it back as much as I thought I was. Where's the home button? There we go. And right over here is Arvin. Click on Arvin. This is what you get You can join the Patreon and make a contribution on a monthly basis, or you can do it by PayPal in any of these denominations. I've gotten quite a few $100 contributions. A lot of them are based on folks appreciating the Tapper Conference, and I'll get back to that in a day or so. We appreciate the videos coming out of the Tapper Conference. So that's what a lot of the $100 contributions have come in, but there's been a bunch of them. But I get a few $1.50s, almost no $3, a few fives, a lot of tens, and a lot of 20s, and a handful of 25s and some 50s. And then here at the Patreon, there we go, currently at 43 patrons, and a monthly total of about $294.61. And that gets billed to any current patron's credit card on about the 5th or 6th of the month. So I just got the collection for January, and it was about $300. So that helps a lot. This is a big part of my job. It's my job. I saw a comedian magician at the last time Cindy and I were in Hawaii. We were told you got to go to this place called Warren and Annabelle's. It's a magic show, which, you know, doesn't seem very Hawaiian. You're in Hawaii, what do? You go to a luau or go surfing or something. But for evenings, nightclub type entertainment, we don't do a lot of that. But over the several times we've been there, people kept saying, you got to go to Warren and Annabelle's. It's in Lahaina on Maui, western end of the Maui island. And you got to go. It's a great show. And so we did. And let me dial it up here. Let's see. Let's see if that's enough to get there. Yeah, Maui Comedy Magic and Dinner Show, Warren and Annabelle's. This ought to be it. Yeah, that's it. So we went there, and this is the guy we saw, John Shyrock. He's the B team. And I think we saw Dana Daniels too. Those guys were the B team because Warren is one of the comedian magicians in the A team. It's his name on the nightclub. But he takes time off. I mean, he goes touring, and so he brings in the B team. If these guys were the B team, Warren's going to be pretty awesome as the A team because we were thoroughly entertained. So it was John that he would do a trick, and this is all very up close magic. It's sleight of hand magic, and it's a small theater. It seats about 70, so no one is very far from the stage, and a lot of people are, you know, sitting at the stage, you know, kind of like I would be sitting. There's the camera I want. You know, this is the stage. He is there, or, you know, maybe a few feet farther back, and the audience is here. They're that close to his card tricks and other sleight of hand magic, and just astounding. We were a couple rows back, but we could see just fine, and just cannot figure out how he's doing things. And so he'll do a trick, and everybody will be going, oh yeah, that's a trick, you know, but I didn't see how you did it. He says, okay, I'll do it again. And he does it again. Did you get it that time? I'll do it again. And he'll do that maybe three, maybe four times, and you don't see how he does it any of those times, and they're all the same. And you're looking, you know, you're looking for the misdirection, you're looking for the, you know, the card that he palms or sticks up his sleeve or whatever, pulls, you know, something from someplace when you weren't watching, you know, when he wants you to be looking over here, and he pulls it out from over there, and you never see it. And he smiles and he says, it's my job. I'll do it again. This is my job. HamRadioNow.tv. I'm Gary Pierce, Scan 4AQ 73. Over and out.